What a wondrous privilege we have once again to worship the Lord together, even if only through online. And to worship the Lord and to meditate on His Word is a great and wonderful privilege, and we are very happy and thankful to the Lord that He has given us this privilege of continuing to meditate upon His Word. His Word, of course, is a lamp unto our feet, and it is also food unto our souls. And yes, we thank the Lord for that. But before I proceed, I'd like to greet Ictus East a very happy 8th anniversary. We would just like to praise the Lord for His faithfulness to our home church. We thank the Lord that He has faithfully guided us, blessed us, and used us as His servants, as His instruments to be a blessing to our community. We pray that the Lord will continue to bless Ictus East, to bless the pastoral staff, the leaders, the many different members of the congregation who are helping and contributing to promote the gospel and the kingdom of God through the ministry of Ictus East. So once again, happy anniversary to Ictus East. We now proceed to the study of the Word this morning. We are studying, of course, the 10th plague, because this message is part of a series of messages on the 10 plagues of Egypt. I think most of you will know what the 10th plague is all about. It is about the Lord striking the land of Egypt and taking the lives of the firstborn, not only the human firstborn, but also the firstborn of the livestock. But my message this morning, based on Exodus chapter 12, verses 1 to 14, will not be focused so much on the plague itself, but on the mercy and compassion which the Lord showed to His people in the midst of judgment. And this is the wondrous thing about our God. He is, of course, a God of judgment because He is a holy God. He will not let sin go unpunished. But He is also a God of mercy and compassion. He is able to provide salvation and forgiveness in such a way that does not compromise His justice. So, the story of the 10th plague is actually a demonstration of God's judgment and mercy. And so the focus of this message this morning will be on the Passover lamb, which the Lord provided as a way for His people to be saved from the judgment inflicted by the angel of death during the imposition of the 10th plague. So the first thing maybe which we should take note of is the fact that this story points towards the Lord Jesus Christ. In fact, the whole book of Exodus is a book about salvation. It does not only retell incidents in the history of Israel. It points towards a greater Exodus. It points towards a greater Passover lamb. It points towards a far greater salvation. But let me not get ahead of myself. At this time, let me just mention what the Lord Jesus said in Luke 24, verses 25 to 27. The Lord Jesus said, "O foolish ones and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken, was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into His glory?" And listen to this. "And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, He interpreted to them in all the scriptures the things concerning Himself." So the Old Testament testifies to the Lord Jesus Christ. And even this particular incident, which we are now studying and meditating upon, the 10th plague and the institution of the Passover lamb, the institution of the Passover, actually points to the Lord Jesus Christ, as we will explain in a little while. So these are shadows of things to come, the substance and reality of which is fulfilled in the Lord Jesus Christ. In this Passover story, let me just summarize it briefly. The Lord commanded that the households, families of Israel should each have a Passover lamb. The lamb should be slaughtered. The blood should be put or placed on the lintel and the two doorposts of the house. And when the angel of death passes and sees the blood, the Lord says, "When I see the blood, I will pass over you, and the plague will not come to that house." And as I said, this points to a far greater salvation. Let me point out to you three things, three pointers, three elements in this salvation story. First, we have a sacrificial lamb. Second, we have the sprinkled blood. And finally, we have the solemn eating. I will try to expound the significance of each element or point as we go along. Let's go to verse 3 of chapter 12 of Exodus, where we see the sacrificial lamb. In verse 3 of chapter 12, the Bible says, "Tell all the congregation of Israel that on the 10th day of this month, every man shall take a lamb according to their father's houses, a lamb for a household." And we know, of course, that later on, this lamb was slaughtered, the blood of the lamb was sprinkled or placed on the lintel and the doorpost, and the angel of death passed by that house, and the plague did not come into that house. The sacrificial lamb. What is the significance of the sacrificial lamb or the Passover lamb? Well, as I said, this is a salvation story. It points to the Lord Jesus Christ. Very interestingly, in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7, the Apostle Paul says, "Cleanse out the old leaven, that you may be a new lump, as you really are unleavened. For Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed." So you see, Paul made use of that story and the element in that story, the Passover lamb, and connected it to the Lord Jesus Christ. The Passover lamb in Exodus 12 actually points to the far greater Passover lamb, which is Jesus Christ himself. In John chapter 1, verse 29, we read, "The next day, John the Baptist saw Jesus coming toward him and said, 'Behold, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world.'" In the original Passover lamb story, the lamb, in a sense, saved the household. But now we have a far greater Passover lamb, which saves not only households, but the whole world. The Lamb of God, which takes away the sin of the world. What are the characteristics of this Passover lamb? In verse 5 of Exodus 12, let me read, the Bible says, "Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male a year old. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats, but the important point to consider here is that the lamb is without blemish." The Lord was making use, God was making use of this incident as a sort of teaching aid for the greater lamb, Passover lamb, which was to come. This was preparatory. This was a way of preparing the understandings of people so that when the far greater Passover lamb would come, the people would understand what kind of sacrifice was needed in order to save us from our sins. The lamb had to be a lamb without blemish. And interestingly, in 1 Peter chapter 1, 19, this is New Testament, the Bible says, "We were redeemed or ransomed with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without blemish or spot." See the connection once again? And in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 14, the Bible says, "How much more will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to God, purify our conscience from dead works to serve the living God. This is very important in the plan or scheme of salvation. The Lamb which had to be sacrificed for us, the Lamb upon which the penalty of our sins had to be put on, had to be a Lamb which was sinless, without blemish, without spot, pure and holy. And that Lamb was Jesus Christ. Not only was it required that the Lamb had to be spotless or without blemish, that Lamb was also a substitutionary sacrifice. In verse 3, once again, let me read once again, Exodus 12, verse 3. The Bible says, "Tell all the congregation of Israel that on the 10th day of this month, every man shall take a lamb according to their father's houses, a lamb for a household." Instead of the firstborn of that family, of that household dying, it was that lamb, in a sense, which was killed, sacrificed, slaughtered in behalf or in the place of that firstborn. So what we have here is, again, a teaching aid. The Lord was preparing our understanding in order for us to understand when the time came what the role of the Passover lamb, the greater Passover lamb, would be. The great Passover lamb in the person of Jesus Christ was supposed to be a substitutionary sacrifice. Instead of us bearing the penalty for our own sins, which we could not carry, the lamb was sacrificed in our behalf. And that was what the great Passover lamb, Jesus Christ, did for us. He was the one who suffered for us. He was the one who took the penalty for our sins. He was the one who died in our place. That's what 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 18 says. "For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit." Let me emphasize once again the words, "the righteous for the unrighteous." The great, spotless, pure, holy Passover lamb was our substitute. He died for us sinners. He died in our place. He died, the Holy One, for sinners like us, so that we might live. The imposition of the penalty for our sins, which is death, was placed instead upon him. We read that also in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 21 to 22. The Bible says, "For our sake he made him to be sin, who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God." This is known as the wondrous exchange. Jesus Christ got our sins. He got the penalty for our sins. And in exchange, we got his righteousness. So much so, he died, and now we live. Through him, we have eternal life. Even though we do not deserve this eternal life because we are sinners, but Christ took upon himself the penalty for our sins, the righteous for the unrighteous. He was made sin. He who knew no sin was made sin in our behalf, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. And finally, the third sub-point under the first point. The Passover lamb, the sacrificial lamb, was not only spotless, it was not only a substitutionary sacrifice, it was slain. Why? Why was there a necessity for this lamb to be slain, and for the great Passover lamb, Jesus Christ, to die? And the answer is found in the Bible, Romans 6:23. "For the wages of sin is death." That is the penalty for our sins. And if the lamb was to die in our place, if the great Passover lamb was to die in our place, as a sacrifice and as a substitute, he had to carry in himself the penalty meant for us. Which penalty is death? Eternal death. That's why in Hebrews chapter 2, verses 14 to 15, the Bible says, "Since therefore the children share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise partook of the same things, that through death he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver all those who through fear of death were subject to lifelong slavery." The justice of God demands that sins be punished. But if we ourselves were to be punished for our sins, then there is no salvation for us. There is no way that we can carry such a heavy penalty. But the great Passover Lamb took that penalty upon himself. That penalty was death. And it was necessary in order to save us that the great Passover Lamb die in our place. That's the third sub-point, the third characteristic of this sacrificial lamb. It had to be slain in the same way that Christ died for us. We go now to verse 7 and to the second point of this message. The Passover lamb was not only a sacrificial lamb, it was also necessary that the blood of this lamb be sprinkled or applied. This is a very important point. Let me read first verse 7 of Exodus 12. Then we will connect this to the New Testament. The Bible says in Exodus 12, verse 7, "Then they shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and the lintel of the houses in which they eat it." The lamb had to be slain and the blood had to be smeared to be put on or sprinkled on the two doorposts and on the lintel above the door of the house concerned. What is the significance of this? Not only did the lamb have to die, it was also necessary that the blood be applied. And if you relate this to the New Testament, the application is simply this. You need to be washed in the blood of the lamb. The death of Jesus Christ will be of no benefit to you. The saving benefits of Christ's death will be of no avail to you if you will not believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and receive Him as your Lord and Savior. The blood of the Lord Jesus Christ has to be applied on the doorposts and the lintel of your souls. That is why the Bible says in Romans 3, verse 25, God has put forward Jesus Christ as a propitiation, an atonement by His blood to be received by faith. The saving death of Jesus Christ will not be effective as far as you are concerned unless you put your faith in Him. Unless you confess your sins, you acknowledge to God, "Lord, I am a sinner, I need to be saved, I cannot save myself. I put my faith in the Lamb who took my sins and who died in my place. I put my faith in Jesus Christ." Then and only then can we say that the blood of the Lamb is applied to your heart, and then you receive the benefits of the death of Jesus Christ, which is salvation from your sins. The warding away, warding off of the penalty of sin, which is eternal death. So, in Hebrews chapter 10, verses 19 to 22, this is what we read. "Therefore, brothers, since we have confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that He opened for us through the curtain, that is, through His flesh, and since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith." Let us draw near. Let us have faith. Let us believe in the Lord Jesus Christ with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. It is not enough that the Lord died. The question is, has the blood of the Lamb, the benefits of that death, been applied to you? Have you received the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? Has the blood of the Lamb been sprinkled upon your heart, sprinkled upon your souls? Has it been applied and received by you by faith? That is the important question. Otherwise, the death of the Lamb will be of no avail to you. The blood of the Lamb had to be smeared and put on the doorpost of the household, on the lintel of the household. We come now to another sub-point under the second point, which is the sprinkled blood, still in verse 7. You will notice that when the blood was put or smeared on the doorpost, on the lintel, you will notice that this was done in order for that fact to be visible. It was done in a visible manner so that when the angel of death passed by the household, the angel could see that the blood has really been applied to that household. And when I see the blood, says the Lord, I will pass over you. Now, what is the significance of this? How do we apply this to our personal lives? The answer is in Romans 10:9. Because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. The application in this is this. In the same way that the smearing of the blood was in a sense a public display that those people were putting their faith and trust in the commands of the Lord, in the same way, when we exercise our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, we must make it visible by means of a public profession of faith. The blood was not smeared inside where no one can see it, where the angel of death could not see it. It was smeared there on the outside so that it could be publicly displayed and it could be visible. In the same way, if we truly believe, then let's boldly and not be ashamed to declare our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. That is true faith. It is bold. It is not ashamed to acknowledge the Lord Jesus Christ as our personal Lord and Savior. And finally, under the second point, let's go to verse 13 of Exodus 12. What else is the significance of the sprinkled blood? Because we are talking about the blood sprinkled visibly on the doorpost and lintel of the house, of the household. The third thing in verse 13, which we find is this. Let me read. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you and no plague will befall you to destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. In other words, there was no condemnation for those who have put their trust in the blood of the Lamb. And that is also true in a far greater sense. And this is the fulfillment of that incident in the Old Testament. There is therefore now no condemnation for them who are in Christ Jesus, for them who have put their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. We find that in Romans chapter 8, verse 1. Not only that, in John chapter 5, verse 24, the Bible says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life." You already have it. He does not come into judgment, but has already passed from death to life. No condemnation, no more plague will come into your house. I will pass over you once I see the blood. And when we are washed in the blood of the Lamb, when we have put our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, he has washed away our sins. We are covered by his righteousness. The penalty, the condemnation of death will no longer be upon us. We are no longer liable to the penalty of death because there is therefore now no condemnation for them that are in Christ Jesus, for those who have put their faith in the great Passover Lamb. No plague, no condemnation. I will pass over you, says the Lord. And we come finally to the third element and to the last point, which is found in verse 8. Let me read verse 8 of Exodus 12. The Bible says in verse 8, "They shall eat the flesh that night, roasted on the fire, with unleavened bread and bitter herbs, they shall eat it." The third point is actually similar to the second point regarding the sprinkled blood. It's a different metaphor, but it has the same message. And that is, you have to partake of the Lamb. You have to partake by faith of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's not enough that you know that he died on the cross for your sins. You have to receive him. And that's the significance of the metaphor eating. You have to solemnly eat the Lamb. You have to eat the Lord Jesus Christ in a sense. And that is what the Bible actually is saying in John chapter 6, verse 53 up to 55. Let me read. John chapter 6, 53 to 55. So Jesus said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. You have to partake of the Passover lamb. You have to receive him into your heart, Jesus Christ. And the Bible says in John 1:12, but as many as receive him, to them he gave the right, the power, the authority to become children of God. Children of God who are protected by his love, who will no longer come into condemnation, who enjoy the privilege and gift of everlasting life. Christ must be eaten. That's the third point. That's what we have to understand. The significance of the eating of the lamb. We too must eat the great Passover lamb. Another thing which we have to understand is that Christ must be eaten whole. We find this once again in verse 10 of chapter 12. And this is very important. Let me read verse 10 of chapter 12. And you shall let none of it remain until the morning. Anything that remains until the morning, you shall burn. What's the point here? The Lord is saying, when you partake of the lamb, when you eat the lamb, eat it whole. Eat everything. And in the same way, if we apply this to our receiving of the Lord Jesus Christ, it's true reception of the Lord Jesus Christ, true faith in Jesus Christ, is not merely taking him as Savior. You take him also as your Lord. In other words, you just don't believe in him so that you'll be free from the penalty of your sins. You take him and receive him as your King, your Master, your Lord. You surrender your life to him. That's true faith, and that requires repentance. That's why in many verses in the Bible, you will find that when the Bible says, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, you will be saved, it also says, repent, and your sins will be forgiven. Now, repentance and faith, they're actually two sides of the same coin. And I will come to that. But firstly, let me point you to Romans chapter 10, verse 9. Because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, see, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. You confess him, you receive him, you take him, not only as your Savior, but also as your Lord. The lamb must be eaten whole. You don't break Christ apart. You can't just say that I will receive him as my Savior so that I won't be punished for my sins, then I will just go live my life the way I want to. That's not how it works. You eat the lamb whole. You receive the Lord as Savior and Lord. You receive Jesus Christ as both Savior and Lord. And that means you both repent and believe. That's what the Bible says in Mark chapter 1, verse 15. The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. This is Mark 1, 15. Repent and believe in the gospel. And in Acts chapter 3, verse 19. Repent and turn back that your sins may be blotted out, that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, and that he may send the Christ appointed for you, Jesus. A person who does not repent does not actually believe, because repentance and faith, they go together. As I said a while ago, repentance and faith are two sides of the same coin. Two sides of the same coin. Saving repentance is a believing repentance. Saving faith is a penitent faith. Repentance and faith, they go together. They are two sides of the same coin. And what God has joined together, let no man put asunder. You eat the lamb whole, you receive Jesus Christ as both your Lord and Savior. And finally, in verse 11 of Exodus 12, the Bible says in verse 11, in this manner, you shall eat it with your belt fastened, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand, and you shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. You eat it in haste. There is a sense of urgency here. You cannot just put this off for the next day. Receiving the Lord Jesus Christ is not, dependent on your whim and pleasure. This is urgent. And the reason why this is urgent, let me just read to you what the Bible says. You must eat it in haste. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 1 and 2. Working together with him, then we appeal to you not to receive the grace of God in vain, for he says, in a favorable time I listened to you. In a day of salvation I have helped you. Behold, now is the favorable time. Now is the day of salvation. Eat it in haste. This is Jesus Christ is now being offered to you as the great Passover lamb, the way of salvation, the only way to receive forgiveness for our sins and have everlasting life. Why do you put it off? Why do you delay? This, now, today, is the day of salvation. James chapter 4 verse 14 says, yet you do not know what tomorrow will bring. What is your life? For you are a mist that appears for a little time and then vanishes. Can you afford to delay? Do you not understand the urgency here? We do not know when our life will end. We cannot be absolutely confident that we will still be here tomorrow. But today, the Lord is offering us the good news of salvation. Partake of the Lamb. Eat the Lamb. But do so in haste. Understand the urgency here. Do not put it off. Now is the day of salvation. Tomorrow may be too late. I would like to close with verse 14, Exodus 12, once again. This shall be for you a memorial day, and you shall keep it as a feast to the Lord throughout your generations, as a statute forever. You shall keep it as a feast. And I believe the fulfillment of this is once again in Jesus Christ. When we receive the Lord Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, when we receive forgiveness for all our sins and eternal life through partaking of the Passover lamb, there is great rejoicing in heaven, an eternal feast, eternal joy. The Bible says in Luke chapter 15, verse 7, just so I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. Every time a sinner turns away from his or her sins and receives the Lord Jesus Christ as his or her personal Lord and Savior, there is a great rejoicing in heaven. The angels are rejoicing while we partake of this great feast, the joyful and wonderful, magnificent and great feast of salvation, the feast of the Passover lamb. Let me close with Revelation chapter 3, verse 20. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and dine with him, eat with him, have a feast with him, and he with me. The feast, the joyful feast of the Passover lamb is calling to you. Will you not partake in haste and be saved from the plague of sin? Let us pray. Lord, we thank you that through this incident in the history of Israel, you have pointed us to the greater Exodus story and the greater Passover lamb, which is the Lord Jesus Christ. I pray that in our worship this morning, in our study of your word, I pray that you will touch and open the hearts of those who have heard your good news. The Lamb of God has been slain in our place so that he may take away the sins of the whole world. Lord, may you cause people to understand, those who are listening this morning, that you have demonstrated your great love towards us, in that while we were yet sinners, the great Passover lamb died in our place. There is mercy in the midst of judgment. May people come to you. May they avail of your mercy, O Lord. May they partake of the Passover lamb in haste, so that they may be joyfully saved from the plague of sin
and death. In Jesus' precious name.